making their own comics or publishing and doing whatever, is to have that there. And
can I just go back to what we were talking about earlier with, for example, the Health and Heroes thing? I mean, it's no secret that we have a huge amount of talent here in the UK, and a huge chunk of them are working for American publishers. Now, what's frustrating for me as a UK publisher is the fact that, knowing this and knowing that we can't compete because of the facilities that we don't have or the funding that we don't have that they have over in the States. And the simple fact is this: if we had a little bit of investment, there is absolutely no doubt in my mind at all that we could produce product of just as high quality, if not better, than anyone out there in the whole world. So what we are lacking at the moment, and that is a lot mainly down to either ignorance in the medium or lack of knowledge in the medium, is a relatively small investment could turn the British comic scene into the force that it deserves and should be.
And was.
And change for British, quite stupid reasons, but that's a story for another day. But the fact is, and we're not talking multi-million pounds, we're talking, you know, a relatively small amount of money in real terms when you look at investment could produce much better content than we have now and compete quite happily. Where we're lacking is because they've built their base and foundations at the right time, you know, when movies have taken off, when investment on a global scale, the internet, all that has basically pushed everything in that neck of the woods, and we've been left behind. And we need to catch up.
And it's so easily exportable as well.
Yeah.
That's the thing, you know, comics, you don't just have to sell to the UK audience. You know, people say, oh, UK comics can never be big because it's such a small country, but you're not just selling to the UK.
No, exactly.
You can sell worldwide.
Yeah.
You can sell to America, you can sell to Europe, you can sell to anywhere.
I mean, the Help for Heroes thing is an example. I mean, we did what we could, and we'll hopefully be able to do it again in contributing some of our older stuff. Okay? Marvel have got an industry going for the American soldiers. I mean, they're earning fortunes out of what they're doing. They're actually doing print runs specifically for the armed forces out there. And they're printing 70, 80,000 books at a time. And actually, it's like a cottage industry for them. And it's everything's heavily sort of weighed in that sort of direction. And we're being left behind. We need to do something about it.
But I think we are.
I think Jonathan Ross needs to empty his wallet a little bit. And
yeah, well, we'll be
the
first advisory board meeting will just lead him down the dark anyway.
And his last meeting.
Did you bring your checkbook?
One of the things we are actually doing, and we have done, is start to build roads with other media quite well. We do talk to the mainstream media a lot more now, newspapers, television. We have quite an impressive contact list throughout the BBC. We start to talk to people in the film industry, some of whom involved in promotion didn't know that a lot of comic book fans are big movie fans. Go figure. So we've started to help them with that, and there'll be cross promotions and things like going on, and people like the BFI and some of the cinema chains, hopefully. We'll get those done, and we'll build it up as much as we can. So we can put comic books into places where film fans are, who aren't aware of the pure breadth of what we take in, then we'll get them in the doors and the shops as well.
But certainly, I think, you know, just within the tie-in with films, but also looking at ways that we can promote comics within places like museums, creating exhibitions and things along those lines that will tie into, you know, something like the V&A or if the Science Museum, there are lots of programs that we're looking at doing where we can sort of build a show or an exhibition for these types of museums using comics, and we can supply the material for that and base something around that that's relevant to what they're doing. But
Book fairs as well. The book fairs, you know, it's pretty scandalous really that now that this entity is formed and we can go there as one entity, you know, we've spoken to the London Book Fair Bureau as an example, and we tried to find a way of getting in there to promote our books, not just to the book industry and the book market within the UK, but globally. You've got all these people coming from around the world looking for rights, and they're effectively, up until this year, effectively what you've got is you've got Diamond and Dark Horse and maybe a couple of other American publishers coming to the London Book Fair to sell their rights internationally, and no British representation at all. Because, for example, Diamond, their core business is Marvel and DC, so they're going to showcase their Marvel and DC. We need to have a representation in the book market as well. That's the future for us in terms of the wider audience, because as much as I hate to say this, comic shops are, you know, they're not, there's not more being informed, they're sort of on a slight decline, and we need to reinforce that and then build a fan base into the book market as well. Again, on a global scale, we do that by, you know, with book fairs and things like that.
I think you said, sorry to interrupt, you know, what you were saying there about comic shops being in decline, I've spoken to a few retailers over the last few years, and there's a lot of new retailers emerging, but they're sort of a little bit lost and how to establish themselves. I think one of the things that's really important as well is giving retailers a foundation when they start, you know, about how to be successful as a retailer.
Small zone, there's a few people come on there and ask if we're
new retailers. And you know, and it's a very difficult retail area, comics. It's very specialised. But I think there is a potential, there are, you know, ways of being a good comics retailer or a good bookshop that specialises in comics. And the, you know, the, a lot of the time it's fans who start out as retailers, and they're just doing it as a fan, and they're not really thinking of it as a business. And I think, you know, a lot of the things we can do is advise retailers when they start, so that they don't start and disappear in 6 months. Yeah. They can actually establish themselves, and we can build up the retail structure of the, you know, the British retailers again.
One of the things that when I put together the comic shops website, which was about 5-6 years ago, it was sponsorship from a fan who literally dropped a check anonymously and said, build it, put all the independent comic retailers in it, and don't charge them. Because he realised a lot of these places don't have a marketing budget. They don't know what they're doing. The only thing that was wrong at the time was he said, no chains. When he pulled out sponsorship because of whatever reason, and I took it on myself, put the chains in, because we have to support everybody.
We have to bring everyone along for this. It doesn't matter how big or how small.
It depends how you regard a chain, because there's a Forbidden Planet chain, which is more corporate, and then I have a chain, six shops, but I'm independent. Mm-hmm. Each shop has an independent manager, albeit employed by me, but he does run the shop his way for that area. And I am the chairman on the board of everybody. Whereas with something like Forbidden Planet, they have 18 people sit around their table and they thrash out their...
Unfortunately, I was attacked when I put the site together because I was hired to do it and I had a remit to follow. And like it or not, that's what I had to do. But I could change that. A lot of the smaller companies said, well, it's not fair because some of the bigger people have massive budgets. But they're in the same problem. They are seeing sales, they have to chase sales like everybody else. And we've evened that up. So please use the sites. Tell your friends to use the site, because then it does support everybody. You can find your local shops.
I'd just like to sort of come back to a bit about what Harry was saying about the London Book Fair. We didn't get involved this year, but this year was the first year that they put together a comics pavilion. We wanted to see how that was, but we will be definitely getting involved next year with that, and probably doing some sponsorship and branding of the Comic Book Alliance there. I attended two panel discussions on comics just on one day. They did a whole load of seminars. Both of them were absolutely rammed. I mean, the rooms were twice as big as this. The one room was twice as big as this, and the other room was about four times as big as this. And they were all heaving, full of publishers who really want to get involved with comics. I personally spoke to people from Walker Books, Egmont, I'm trying to think who else, there was pretty much everyone, Cine Books, they all want to be part of this, and they've all pledged to get involved with the CBA and to help us out. So it's not just coming from what we would consider sort of the core comics industry here, but it's also coming from the book industry who want to be involved as well.
It's big business for them. I mean, Random House and HarperCollins are doing quite well out of it.
Exactly.
And it's, you know, they do things differently to the way us publishers do it within the industry, yeah. and a collaborative effort would work for both sides.
Well, I was going to say, I think there's lessons, sides, because they don't really understand the fan base.
No. But they've got the distribution in place and the marketing.
Exactly.
So we could do with their help and they could do with their help.
Yeah.
So, you know, at some point we meet, it'd be very nice.
Yeah, no, we'll be doing that. So, you know, there's a lot of exciting stuff that's ongoing, that's developing along at the moment.
It was interesting.